right, guys, so let's see. Randy, have a seat. Right over here. IC-10-9, welcome. So I was talking about this thing today, and I was trying to explain what happened. So today was, what is today?
Today is Saturday, a couple of days before Juneteenth.
Okay, Saturday, June
the
17th. Okay.
Yes. Oh, and the day before Father's Day.
The day before Father's Day, okay. June 17th, all right? So, Dad, happy Father's Day. That's tomorrow.
Happy Father's Day, Dad.
All right, that's Randy. So, what happened? I was looking at this work of art, trying to figure out, I decided that this would be the topic of discussion for today. And what happened, I started editing the video. I recorded myself talking about this, explaining this work of art. And then I pulled up the video with Giancarlo Esposito as Bugging Out. And I was trying to explain how I was in the desert and a situation similar to what happened to the character, Bugging Out. Something that happened to him in the movie happened to me. And so I took that little sample, that little scene, and I edited it into the video. And when I did that, that's when I noticed those numbers. So that's like the most interesting thing that happened today. Like, the point of this video is everything is in plain sight. Everything is hidden in plain sight. So, you know, I've just been paying attention to, you know, my number 109, right? I've just been paying attention to it. But there are numbers that are talking to you, that are searching for you as well, that are revealing, you know, secrets. So if you pay attention to them, maybe it'll lead you down a rabbit hole, but it'll lead you to other information. It's a way of learning. That's the way I look at it. So yeah. So basically what happened is Bugging Out in the movie had his shoe scuffed, and what else happened? Yeah, so in that scene he passes by the radio station. The radio station on in the movie Do the Right Thing is FM 108, right? That movie was made more than 30 years ago, right? But it's always been there and no one's ever paid attention to it. And so the idea that I had a personal experience that was similar to or that was reminiscent of the scene in the movie, like, that's bizarre. Like, okay, Randy, have you had a situation like that?
Always. Well, not always, but I have.
You've had a situation where someone scuffed your shoe and you feel like, oh, I'm bugging out?
Like, or disrespected?
Yeah.
Well, maybe not my shoe, but something, like, I've been, like, disrespected. Like, something happened, like, maybe pushed or something.
Okay. But what I'm saying is specifically...
The shoe.
Stepped on the shoe. Maybe it's a guy thing where we're so... Maybe not, because I think anybody... When I picture the students at Dorsey High School, I think that if you buy a fresh pair of sneakers, you don't want anyone stepping on, especially if they're Jordans. Mm-hmm. So there's that. And Giancarlo Esposito's character had Jordans on, so he was very protective about, you know, the $100 he spent on those nice Jordans and whatever. So my point is, with the shoes, I had a particular experience that was like paralleled that experience. I was in the desert, but I was having an experience like Bugging Out, Giancarlo Esposito's character. And the whole thing is, like, I wrote my book. My book is called 109, right? That's my book, 109. And the fact that 109 includes a reference to Do the Right Thing, But then it also has a reference to the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Like, that wasn't planned. It's just, it was a coincidence. It was like, oh, okay, these stories in these popular things, the popular movies and TV shows
Pop culture,
in
like.
pop culture, these pop culture events that we share, that we know, okay, they all had some connection to my experience. So by the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, Will Smith rapped, whistled for a cab, and when it came near, the license plate said fresh, and it had dice in the mirror. If anything, I could say this cab was rare, but I said, nah, forget it, your home's to Bel-Air. And this is the theme song of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. So there's Will Smith's character, the Fresh Prince, going to Bel-Air. He needs a cab. He whistles, the cab comes, and the cab is like it was made just for him because it has the license plate that reads Fresh. His name is the Fresh Prince. Fresh, okay, it's simpatico, it matches him. And so his feeling when he sees the license plate is, hey, this is different. This is rare. And this is unique, right? And this is special. He notices that it says, fresh, but there are dice in the mirror as well. So he's like, yo, that's my vibe. That's me, okay? That's who I am. And then he says, oh, forget about all that. Let's go to Bel Air. And that's the verse. That's what he says. Cut to my experience. I'm in the desert of all places of Saudi Arabia. I whistle for a cab. I didn't literally whistle. It was the next cab in line. And then I had had all these moments where I had seen 109 and under peculiar circumstances, from Korea to then, Ethiopia to Cuba, Mexico, like all of these places. And here I was back in Saudi Arabia having another experience. I didn't expect it, but the next taxi cab that came in line had the numbers 109 on the license plate, just like Fresh. So there was simpatico with me, and I'm like, oh. So now I'm feeling a little nervous, like, wait a minute, what's happening? It's happening again. Here are these numbers, they're matching with me. Because if I had been there 1 minute earlier, that taxi would have gone to another person, another passenger in line. If I had been a minute later, or a minute earlier, or a minute later, I would not have had the same position in line, and that taxi would have gone to someone else, and I wouldn't have this story. So it's like it was fate. It was destiny for me to see those numbers to be matched with that taxi cab. And then I say, I changed the lyric. First, I said, nah, forget it. Have no fear. This is what I said, for the verse initially. Have no fear. Like, don't be afraid of these numbers. Go with these numbers. It's your destiny, sort of thing. But then I thought about it and I said, wait a minute. I need to stick to the lyrics. So I'm going to stick to the lyrics of the Will Smith's lyrics. And those lyrics are, not forget it, yo home's to Bel Air. And then here's the part that really gets me. Bel Air has a fire department and it's number 109. That's simpatico right there. Like, so it really was like kind of destiny to find, to be matched with the car, but not only to be matched with that taxi cab, but also to have the experience just like the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Because when I was trying to write about that experience of seeing those numbers, I thought only of the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. I thought of Will Smith because he had already explained what I needed to explain. I was like, oh, there it is. There it is right there. So going back to this experience. So, okay, one, I had the experience that was like Will Smith and the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. And two, I had this experience like do the right thing. Now, I don't live my life, thinking about, oh, I'm standing in a bank. this is like that movie, or oh, I'm gonna go to a restaurant. Oh, this reminds me of Pulp Fiction. Oh, you know, nah, I don't do all this, okay? But this is kind of how it's been unfolding, and it's like, wow, this is wild. So with bugging out, my story is about 109, and 109 is the number of the teacher. The teacher, my job is to teach you about 108. And in the moment, or in the story, when I talk about this moment in my life that looks like or matches or parallels the movie Do the Right Thing, that scene or that experience that I had in life that mirrors that scene contains two numbers in it. It contains the number 108. Because my job as the teacher, 109, that's my number. But the number that I'm supposed to teach you about is 108. All right? And who is 108 but this guy right here, right? He died March 31st, 2019, at the age of 33. And in that scene, in this scene that parallel my life's experience, in that scene, the two numbers you see are the number 108 and the number 33. It's right there, plain as day, but it was hidden. It was hidden to all of us because, of course, we hadn't learned what these things mean. So my question then is, for the person who designed the set on Do the Right Thing, did they take yoga? Were they into yoga? Were they into Hindu philosophy? Were they hip to this information? Because when they chose 108 for the FM radio station, FM 108, I'm like, that's a highly significant, a highly sacred number in the heavens, in the celestial, among, you know, if you study astronomy, boom, 108, there's your answer. It's a very sacred number because the Hindu, the Buddhist, and the Jainist, and all of these people, we're talking hundreds of millions of people are familiar with the numbers, you know, 108. So.
Can I add something?
Of course.
What about the number of breaths? I know I'm not saying it correctly, okay. And I know you spoke about it like in previous like videos.
So the question, the question I think you're asking is, how does the number 108 relate to us, to the human body?
Right.
Okay. First, it's a celestial number because the number of moons between us and the moon, it's 108. That's an important number. The number of suns between the sun and earth is 108. So when you see a repetition of these numbers in the celestial bodies in the heavens, then that means it's important. That's not what I'm saying. That's what I'm teaching, because this is an idea that comes from, you know, other traditions that we don't hear of or learn about. Now, I said that to answer your question, how does it relate to the human body? Well, there's the idea that as above, so below. So that means that what's in the heavens matches what's on earth. And that's where algebra comes from. Algebra says X equals Y, that one part of the equation equals the other side. So as above, so below. It balances out. Life balances itself out. And so just as 108 is important in the heavens, right here within our bodies, if our temperature rises, if the human body's temperature rises to 108 degrees, we die. The human, our organs shut down. 108 degrees Fahrenheit, it's a wrap, okay? Before that, we get very bad temperatures and then you get headaches and all that kind of stuff. But at 108, you're dead, okay? That's the threshold. That's one idea. But the breath. We breathe, a healthy human being will breathe 108 times 100. 108 multiplied by 100 times. That is 10,800 times. We breathe that many times during the day, and we also breathe that many times at night. How do you get 10,800 in the day? How do you get 10,800 at night? You multiply 108 times 100. So just as important as it is in the sky, in the heavens, it's as important with our human bodies, because breath we breathe, the breath that we breathe is linked to that number 108.
Which is life.
So 108 is life. I can break down, well, maybe not I, you know, but if you ask a numerologist, if you ask someone who is a, you know, maybe a Hindu or a yoga practitioner, and you ask them the significance of 108, maybe they will be able to tell you this. You can Google it, of course. That information is there. That's where I found a lot of this information.
I like that another thing.
Yes.
One more thing. So if you equate 108 to life, your picture behind you, like from Do the Right Thing, and then Nipsey, and then those, you know, this whole picture, and then you talk about the clip from Do the Right Thing, and the two numbers that you happen to see, 108 from the radio station, and then, oh, okay, you already discussed it, and 33?
Yes.
On the jersey or the shirt. So 108 appears first, that's life, and then Nipsey also died when he was age of 33, and that number came last. So it's kind of the cipher,
as
you always
gosh.
Talk about.
That wasn't me, that came from Randy. Randy looked at that and said, the first number that you see in the scene is 108, which is a metaphor for life. And then in that scene, we see the death, because at 33, Christ died at 33.
Right.
Nipsey died at 33 as well. So,
and
wow.
During his journey, he rode the 108 bus, like, you know.
Right. See, the
journey in life.
Why do I keep talking about Nipsey? Like, okay, for one, I'm like really, you know, in awe of his success. You know, he dropped out of high school, didn't go to college, and yet he was able to capture the imagination, the hearts and minds of people around the world. Who does that? How does that happen? Right? So that's one reason. But the other reason is because I saw 109 the day that Nipsey died. I saw 109 the day Nipsey died. The day that I got the news about Nipsey, I was saddened, and it affected me deeply. And it was a strange thing because I never met him. All I knew was that he was from Los Angeles, my hometown, and he was wildly successful, and he was growing in success, and I couldn't deny it. And I was a full-fledged fan. 2018, I was a full-fledged Nipsey Hussle fan. I went to the Marathon clothing store. I bought my gear and everything. I remember 109, Nipsey, and then something miraculous, something unbelievable. One day, 7 days, within 7 days of Nipsey's, you know, of Nipsey leaving us, of Nipsey's passing, within 7 days, seven is a biblical number. Within 7 days, I walk outside of my home in the desert, and I see something that I can't explain. I see lines in the sky, and I know airplanes didn't make those lines. They were too close to the ground to have been created by airplanes. And then it was so peculiar because those lines formed a cross or a crucifix. And it's like, okay, even if airplanes flew at that low altitude, are you telling me that one airplane flew in that direction and the other one flew perpendicular to it, creating what looked like to be a perfect cross in the sky? You're telling me that is what happened on that particular day and never happened before that or after it again? And I lived there for 7 months?
7 months.
Here
we go, 7 again.
That part. So it's like, you know, we live in a capitalist society, and I want to keep it transparent. I want to sell my story. I want this story to get out there. It's all true, and yeah, I want the story to sell, and I'm not trying to give you, you know, Eastern philosophy. I'm not trying to give you a new religion. I'm not trying to give you anything that isn't already there. I'm just saying, look, people, this is a different perspective. And yeah, if you look in this direction, you're gonna see perhaps what I see. But the thing about it is, there's a preacher and his sermon. He made a video. I watched it yesterday, so it was posted 9 days ago. So today would be the 10th day that it was released, that he posted it on YouTube. The topic of his sermon is Jesus is coming really soon. Jesus is coming soon. And so he's using all of his Bible knowledge to present information to the people. But he said in his video, he said, look, folks, you know, I'm not trying to lead you. I'm not trying to tell you definitively this is what it is. He said, this is just a fun activity for us to explore. Let's just look at the information that we have, that we're given from the Bible, and let's just talk about this. So it's just a jumping off point for discussion. This is not, you're not wrong, I'm not right, and all of this kind of stuff. No, I'm just laying the facts out. I was in the desert. I scuffed my shoe. A goat scuffed my shoe, and I felt like bugging out. The day Nipsey died, I saw 109 on a car that cut me off. I can go into that story about how there were only two cars on the road. Imagine that. I was coming out of the airport. The next taxi in line was for me. It was 109. So these moments, when I have these 109 moments, it's all part of the story that I'm selling. So go to my website, ic109.store, pick up a copy of IC109 or of 109. Excuse me, that's the name of the story. And breathe. If you ever get stressed, make sure that you breathe. Healthy human body 10,800 times during the day, 10,800 times at night. Anything else that I forgot?
No, stay tuned. There's more.
Yep. Like, subscribe, click that notification bell, check out the other videos. Yep. And this artwork is also for sale. Money, 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 money. Money. Okay, y'all, peace. 109 or 109 is an idea as much as it is a number. I call it 10-9. To understand 10-9, it takes a creative mind willing to explore numerology, psychology, history, philosophy, and statistics. IC109 explores the mysterious interpretations of this number from a myriad of perspectives. All right, everybody, welcome. Let me get mic'd up. All right. Welcome to another IC109 podcast. Well, this isn't actually a podcast, but this is a presentation by me. I'm Larry Wiggs, and this is what I talk about, okay? First, shout out to Albert Diaz, the artist of this work right here. I bought this. Has it been a year? I don't remember exactly when I bought it. But I have another work of art over there by Albert Diaz, and I ordered that work of art, and when I got it, that was like 2, maybe 3 years ago now. I noticed that Albert had numbered his works of art. Actually, there were only 20. There are 20 works, right? Out of the 20 works that from which they chose to send me that work of art, which is over there on that wall, I got number 10. I got number 10, right? And then a few years later, I ordered another work of art from Albert Diaz, and this is the second work that I ordered. And again, it's out of 20 that were produced, and this is number 9. 10, 9, right? They don't know me. It was just a random order, and they were shipping Albert's artwork cross country, and I got 10 and I got 9, years apart. I bought them at least 2 years apart. That was around 2020. This one may be 2022. So 10-9, y'all. I see 10-9. That's what it's about, right? I can't explain this stuff. It's just happening. It's just stuff that I notice. Come with me. I want to talk about this work of art, which I produced, I created, and I was inspired to create this because of all of these 10-9 situations. I was like, how come 10 and 9 keep attracting 10 and 9? What's that all about? Here's a story for you represented in this work of art. I hope you can see it. All right. I don't want to turn my back to my audience, but you know, it is what it is. All right. I hope you can see everything. All right. I want to explain it. It's not every day that you get an opportunity for the artist to explain their work. And maybe even it's not even necessary for the artist to explain the work. But hey, it is what it is, you know. So let's start with I have this sticker here. It says same old since 1978. Same old. Well, that's what Albert Diaz and Jean-Michel Basquiat created. They created this this tag. They created this. The tag was based upon a religion. These were like 16-year-old boys, you know, thinking about their existence and what have you. And they came up with the idea of creating a religion. Same old is the name. Do some research on that. Whatever. When I bought these works of art, at one time I bought some stickers by Albert Diaz, and one of the stickers was this same old sticker. And I just figured I'll put that on there just to give, pay homage and also to represent, you know, same old because of inspiration, you know. Jean-Michel Basquiat and Albert Diaz inspired me through same old. I learned about same old 2004, 2005, right? Anyhow. Related to Jean-Michel Basquiat, Albert Diaz, graffiti artist. I have a few crowns here. I have a crown here, a crown there, and a crown there. You know, the crown is very significant in graffiti art. You see that, you know, everywhere.
Now, the thing about the crown is a graffiti thing that no one fucking invented. It's just like, you know, I mean, there were some early examples of it. But Jean didn't. Some people think that's his crown.
Right.
It's his crown. He has his own crown.
Yeah.
But there were many people who did crowns before him and continue to do crowns after. That's my crown. That's another one of my crowns. But graffiti artists, you know.
Okay. For the layperson or for someone who doesn't know me, doesn't know my story, they'll probably look at this and say, well, what is he talking about? What do I see? You know, I see some goats. I see a picture of, what is this, Giancarlo? Oh, there's another crown. I forgot to mention that. Giancarlo Esposito, I believe that's his name, the actor. And he was playing the role of Bugging Out on Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing, you know, that movie. Like, what do I see? I see bugging out. I see some goats. Okay. I see some tennis shoes. I see some religious iconography. Okay. Like, what am I looking at? All right. Let's start here in the center. This is a screenshot of someone's Instagram page, right? And what they did is they were uploading posts related to the month of March. And this was around 2019 when they did this. And so the month of March 2019 was quite significant to me because I was really focused on East Africa, East African things at that time. Seth, I have a former colleague named Seth, and I remember him sending me messages, you know, on WhatsApp, and he was telling me, he actually informed me of the Ethiopian Airlines plane crash. He was like, man, an Ethiopian Airlines, you know, an Ethiopian Airlines airplane crashed. That's because I wasn't paying attention. I wasn't listening to the radio or the news. Actually, I didn't even have the news. I didn't have a television in my home. I was just getting all my information from Instagram and from the people I'm connected with. Seth has traveled to Ethiopia. Seth has his own reasons for, you know, loving Ethiopia. And I was inspired to travel to Ethiopia because of Seth. But also because of another colleague, Gable. These two guys are about my age, roughly. And they had traveled to Ethiopia and they just basically raved about it. TJ is another colleague who told me about Ethiopia. And he told me which tour group to sign up with. So it was TJ, it was Seth, and it was Gable. And these guys just basically told me, go to Ethiopia. And I was like, I've been meaning to. I've been learning about Ethiopia. I've been watching Dr. Henry Louis Gates Jr.'s documentaries, and I'm like, yo, I want to see what he saw. You know, the Yale graduate or Harvard professor, you know, graduated from Yale, African American studies, and I was like, I want to know more about Ethiopia. I want to travel there. And when I heard from TJ, Seth, and Gable that Ethiopia is the place, then I was like, I was sold. I was like, man, I'm going. Plus, TJ, Seth, and Gable are all white dudes. And I'm like, I'll be damned if some white boys know more about Ethiopia than me. So I was like, I've got to go to Ethiopia. All right. But yeah, Seth messaged me and told me that the Ethiopian Airlines crashed, plane crashed. And then I went to the internet and I started, you know, searching for the information. So there was a shift because I was riding high on the Battle of Adwa celebrations, because when I got this information in 2019, I had already traveled to Ethiopia. I actually traveled to Ethiopia in 2017, so 2 years before 2019, I traveled to Ethiopia for the first time, and guess what? I arrived in Ethiopia on March 31st, 2017. All right, remember that. So anyhow, I got this from Instagram. I don't know whose post it is, but this person posted this, and it was perfect because it really highlighted the events of March 2019. It highlighted the events related to Ethiopia or East Africa that basically I was focused on, all right? So I circled them. First, it was the Battle of Adwa, the 123rd anniversary right there. That's what I was, you know, happy about during the month of March. And then there were 9 days later when the Ethiopian Airlines crashed, and then I was all saddened. But it wasn't only my sadness or my, you know, happiness for, you know, the Battle of Adwa, you know, celebration, the Battle of Adwa, there it is. It was also a shared emotion among Ethiopians because these were events historic and also current events that affected the lives of Ethiopians. So this is what my mind was on. I was like, dang, man, that's pretty interesting. I learned about the Battle of Adwa and I'm celebrating it. 9 days later, Ethiopian Airlines crashed, and I'm like, oh man, this is terrible. And then by the end of the month, on March 31st, 2019, Nipsey Hussle, you know, is gone. Sadly, we lose Nipsey on that day. So yeah, Nipsey was Eritrean, but Adwa, Aksum, the Bible, go back to in history and Eritrea and Ethiopia were one. So that's why I'm like, I don't, you know, don't separate. Don't say Nipsey was Eritrean and leave it at that. No, you've got to go back to that time when, you know, there were no geopolitical lines, you know, separating these two nations. So that's something to think about. So this right here is basically what happened in the month of March. That's what happened in the month of March. Three events that captivated my attention. And I thought that there were some sort of coincidences. There were some connections. There was some synchronicity. I was wondering, why did these things happen? You know, like I was happy at one moment, and then something in the world was saying, no, you're not going to sit down. You're not going to be happy. We're going to do this. It seemed like, you know, the strings of the invisible hands of some oligarch or some Illuminati, you know, was making sure to, you know, suppress and subjugate, you know, or whatever. And then with Nipsey Hussle, that whole thing, it was just like, what? How is the month of March so focused on Ethiopia and Eritrea or East Africa? How is it so focused? There are these three major events. Like, Nipsey's passing was major. It was a major event for Los Angeles, but then it had ripple effects throughout the globe. The Ethiopian Airlines crash, that just had ripple effects throughout the globe. Like, man, that just put fear in people. And in my case, I was actually planning a trip to Ethiopia and Eritrea, well, on Ethiopian Airlines. Well, I was going to go to Eritrea, but I was going to fly Ethiopian Airlines, and the hub airport of Ethiopian Airlines is in Ethiopia. So you'd have to go through Ethiopia to get to Eritrea. So I was already like, oh man, Ethiopian Airlines airplanes are crashing. I'm not about to do that one. I'm not about to fly there, you know? So the month of March was really about, you know, these three events for me. It was very clear in my mind that the month of March 2019 belonged to Ethiopia, right? Because of all of this. What all of this represents around here is, you know, during the month of March, like each Sunday, for some reason, it was each Sunday, it was a 7 day. There were 7 day intervals when I would take a photo. This was not planned. This just happened. There were 7 day intervals when I would take a photo, and that photo seemed, only in hindsight, I didn't know this when I took the photo though, it seemed to foretell, you know, the event of Nipsey's passing. It was like a premonition. It was telling me, because when I looked back on my pictures, I thought, man, that's really bizarre. All right, so check out what happened. Okay. Okay, in the painting, in the work of art. See, I was inspired to write a poem, and these are the words of the poem. Okay, so the poem says, "I began to think these coincidences are signs. Why else would a man's death coincide?" With the same week as is celebrated Muhammad's rise, peace be upon him. Okay, so when Nipsey died, it was also the week of Eid, the Eid celebration, but it's also the celebration of Easter, and you know, so very close, you know, very close. It was like, dang, he died around that time. Wow. And the thing about that week is that there were like See, I was preparing for that trip to Eritrea because it was going to be a holiday for me, because I was so far, I was not in Los Angeles. I was in the country of Oman. I was a teacher. I taught English out there. And maybe I didn't mention that. I should have mentioned that earlier. I was in Oman, and the Eid celebration was coming up, right? I was thinking about the Eid celebration. I was going to go to Eritrea. Why Eritrea? Because I'm a world traveler. I haven't been to Eritrea. And because I was close to Eritrea from Oman, you know, it's a few hours, maybe like a 5 hour journey. Well, there is a layover in Ethiopia, so that's actually a short travel, short distance. So that's why I was thinking about Eritrea. Because I'd been to Ethiopia and I was already aware of the Aksumite Empire, so I was like, let me see the other nations part of the Aksumite Empire. And the thing is, I've already lived in Saudi Arabia, and I couldn't go to Yemen because of the war. So it was like, well, Eritrea is safe. Let's go over there. All right. So the celebration was coming up. Nipsey dies. It's like the week, days before Easter, and it's the week of the Eid celebration for Islam. All right. So let's continue. In other words, that same week, Muslims celebrated Muhammad, peace be upon him, ascension to heaven. Wow. The prophet's ascension to heaven, and we lose Nipsey, and he presumably ascended to heaven as well. Like, whoa, that's deep. And then I say, it's funny how every 7 days leading up, I was greeted by a new revelation. Seven, right? 7 days. Of course, this is in hindsight. This is me looking back, in retrospect. I was like, whoa, look at the pictures I posted to Instagram. All right, so we start with 28 days earlier, Ethiopians felt elated. That's where I was talking about how I felt. But my feelings, I'm sure, extended to Ethiopians, because they annually they have a celebration to celebrate the Battle of Adwa. Ethiopians felt elated because the 123rd Adwa Day was celebrated. Okay, so that's setting up the month right there, Adwa. 21 days earlier, so that's 7 days, right? So by earlier, I'm saying, Nipsey Hussle's, last day, that is day zero, right? And if we count backwards 28 days and count in 7 day increments, then this is what I'm retelling. I'm saying, look at all that occurred in the month of March. All right, so day 28. Battle of Adwa celebrated 21 days, 7 days later. 21 days earlier, and Ethiopian feelings turned to deflated when Ethiopian Airlines Flight 302 was annihilated. What coincidence? What connection does this have to do with Nipsey? Nothing, really. But it's the idea that it happened during the month of March at this time, and it caused me to focus on the month of March. It caused me to focus on Ethiopia or East Africa. That's my point. Like, you can go through a whole month and not hear anything about a certain region of the world, and here I am, March 2019, I'm getting news every 7 to 10 days about East Africa. Like, whoa, what's happening, right? Focus, man. Look carefully. What's happening? That's what it was like. All right. So that happened. Next, 7 days later, 14 days earlier, I posted a picture of a goat to IG. That's where this goat comes from. Since it disrespected me, that's where Giancarlo Esposito comes in. Disrespected me by stepping on my new blue lace Nike sneaks. Blue lace Nike sneaks, okay? Blue laces represents, Nipsey. Nipsey. These are the shoes that I bought. Blue lace Nike sneaks. I felt like bugging out from Do the Right Thing. This is supposed to be a comical connection because like that was an interesting scene, right? Giancarlo Esposito had his shoe scuffed on the street in Brooklyn. The white guy is like, "Oh, you know, sorry, man." And Giancarlo's, you know, starts bugging out. Like, "No, man, you don't just come in my neighborhood or buy a brownstone on my block and da 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 da." And he runs through that. He just runs it down.
You almost knocked me down, man. The word is excuse me.
Excuse me, I'm sorry.
Not only did you knock me down, you stepped on my brand new white Air Jordans that I just bought. And that's all you can say is excuse me.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I'm serious. I'll fuck you up quick two times. Who told you to step on my sneakers? Who told you to walk on my side of the block? Who told you to be in my neighborhood?
I own this brownstone.
Who told you to buy a brownstone on my block, in my neighborhood, on my side of the street? Yo, what you want to live in a black neighborhood for anyway, man? Motherfuck gentrification.
Well, as I understand it, this is a free country. Man can live wherever he wants.
Free country? Man, I should fuck you up for saying that stupid shit alone.
Yo, man, your Jordans are fucked up.
Damn, man, you might as well throw them shits out. Them shits is broke.
Man, they looked at it good before he messed them up. He did this shit on purpose, man. He was even talking about your mom.
What that shit to me? He's so fine.
Yo, man, how much you pay for him?
$100
American dollars.
108 with tax.
I give him 100 headaches.
Look, you're lucky the black man has a loving heart. Next time you see me coming, man, you cross the street quick.
I'm out of here.
Yo, man, bring his feet. Come on,
George. Take his dollar. I should make you buy me another pair.
Take black Panther, whoop his ass.
Take his bike.
Kick his ass.
Man, you're lucky I'm a righteous black man. Otherwise, you'd be in serious trouble, man. Serious.
Fuck him up.
Then why don't you move back to Massachusetts?
I was born in Brooklyn.
And he felt disrespected. So here I am. I just bought my new Blue Lace Nike sneaks. Now, before I continue, I have to make it very clear. Okay, I'm from Los Angeles, and in Los Angeles, you don't buy Blue Lace sneakers. You don't buy, you know, blue shoes. I mean, unless you are trying to communicate to the world something about the meaning of those blue shoes and those blue shoelaces, okay? In my case, I was far removed from Los Angeles. I'm halfway around the globe. There's no meaning to blue shoes, blue laces, nothing like that. There's nothing to it. They're just shoes. And in my case, I bought them because they're just shoes and because they were the only shoes that they had in my size, right? I was like, yo, I like that style. Don't particularly care for the color, but they have my size. Let's go. Let's do it. So I bought those shoes. I bought these shoes not thinking of the connection that they had to Nipsey. I wasn't thinking about Nipsey's songs, Blue Laces 1 and 2, Nipsey, Rolling 60s, and all of this stuff. I wasn't thinking about that at all. Now, I am a Nipsey Hussle fan, and I was listening to Nipsey Hussle back in 2018 and 2019, and I was very much a Nipsey Hussle fan. But I wasn't so much a fan that I was like, yo, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna buy some blue shoes and blue laces thinking I'm Nipsey. No. They were just my size, okay? Not that I haven't bought shoes, you know, that were inspired, by Nipsey. The very first pair of Pumas I bought, Puma Suedes, you know, the Clydes, you know, or the shoes that were popularized by the basketball player Clyde, who I don't actually know much about, but I learned about when I was wearing the shoes. Anyhow, what was I saying? I did buy a pair of those Clydes, you know, based upon Nipsey. And I was like, man, I want a pair of those Pumas. So I did do that. But these shoes, no, I wasn't doing it because of Nipsey. I was doing it because it was my size, all right? I have to be very clear about that, okay? Yeah, Nipsey influenced my purchases. I do wear, you know, TMC clothing today because of Nipsey, but not when I bought those shoes, no. So anyway, there I am in the desert with these shoes on, and then I'm taking pictures of these goats, because when are you in Los Angeles? Like, when does an Angelino ever see goats in their neighborhood? Okay, when do you see goats in your neighborhood? Like, never, right? But there I was, thousands of miles away, and I saw some goats, and I'm like, man, this is crazy. So I'm like taking photos of the goats to send the posts or upload the post to Instagram to share with my friends and family and whomever who can get a kick out of it and say, dang, look at Larry. He's all the way halfway around the globe with goats in his neighborhood. Look at this. That's wild, you know? That's all I wanted to do. But as I'm taking those photos of those goats, one of the goats approaches me. This goat approaches me. The hoof lands on my foot in a very disrespectful manner, scuffs up the shoe. I feel like bugging out. I want to fight this goat. Okay. And the goat stares at me. The goat just stares at me. And I'm like, wow, what's happening in this moment? And the goat just stood on my foot. And I'm just like, this is an interesting moment. So I snapped those photos and posted them to Instagram, and I said what I said about the goat, looking up at me, and you know, I played with the idea that the goat was communicating with me, saying, "What's up, player? You're not in your neck of the woods anymore. You're in my neighborhood. You're in my hood, homeboy. And yeah, I stepped on your foot. So what you gonna do about it, man?" Kind of that sort of thing, you know, that's where the disrespect came from. But then I read some more into it, like, yo, that goat was communicating with me. He stepped on my foot to say, look, don't pay attention to material objects, material things. There's something bigger that's happening. Pay attention. This is what I imagine the goat was saying to me, like, whoa, right? But I posted these photos and just thought nothing of it. I thought it was, you know, funny, cute, funny little story or whatever, right? All right. Felt like bugging out. And then 7 days earlier in an IG photo I posted, I wore one sock on my right foot while lying in a tent eating Oreos while reading a book. That's that picture right there. All right. This represents everything that was happening on that day, 7 days before we lost Nipsey, okay? So let's go back, all right? This day, the Battle of Ottawa, boom. This day, the airplane drop, boom, right there, right? Then we've got, let's see, Nipsey's death. Nipsey's right here. Nipsey's right here. And then I was saying 28 days earlier, the Battle of Ottawa, we got that represented. 21 days later, Ethiopian Airlines, we got that represented there. 14 days earlier, a goat. The goat is represented here. And then 7 days earlier, a photo on IG. Here's the photo on IG. And this represents the photo on IG. All right. Now this photo here, let me talk about it. I was in the desert. You may not be able to see it. It's a little, let me put this down a little bit. See if we can see that in there. Gotta hurry up, running out of power. I was in the desert reading this book. This book right here, this is Panther Baby. The book is entitled Panther Baby by Jamal Joseph. I had these Oreos on my belly. I was eating some Oreos. I had there's the book, yeah. I was wearing one sock on my foot because I had a foot fungus. I was dealing with the foot fungus on my right foot, and I needed some attention. I put some ointment, I put some gel, and it was healing, and so I didn't want that gel to get smeared on the floor, so I put a sock on, and that sock was on my right foot. Why is that sock important? Why is it significant? Because when we lost Nipsey, Nipsey was being carried out on a gurney, and he had one sock on his left foot. So he had a sock on his left foot, I had a sock on my right foot. And that photo was taken 7 days before we lost Nipsey, okay? So that's what all of that means. So everything has some meaning. And, you know, spirituality, Ethiopia, black man, you know, sainthood, black, you know, black Jesus, all of this. This is what this image represents, because all of this, man, all of this was all, it all happened, and it was like miraculous to me. All right, so that's how I explain all of the events that are represented in this artwork, okay? All right, peace.